Hello. Welcome you all back to lecture series in political theory. I'm Professor H. Srikant. You know, I have earlier come out with a series of lectures on Marxist political theory. Now I have started a new series of lectures on liberal and critical theory. As part of the new series, I have released one YouTube lecture recently on Frankfurt School and critical theory. In continuation of my lectures on Frankfurt School, I'm delivering this lecture on Horkheimer and Adorno's theory of culture industry. In my previous lecture that I just referred, I told you that Max Horkheimer became the director of the Frankfurt School in 1922. Then immediately he shifted the research focus of the institute from political economy to culture and psychoanalysis. I have also informed you that because of the Nazi threat, Horkheimer had to shift the Frankfurt School to the USA. The interwar period gave him an opportunity to observe developments in Europe and also in America. In collaboration with Theodore Adorno, in 1942, he published the work Dialectic of Enlightenment. The work focused on the contradictions and dilemmas of the Western capitalist societies. It discussed the interconnection between economy, media, culture, psychology, and other aspects. In the work, there is one article titled Culture Industry, Enlightenment as Mass Deception. This article attracted the attention of the most readers. In this article, Horkheimer and Adorno put forward their ideas on the then emerging culture industry. Later, Adorno, in collaboration with other scholars, worked more elaborately on the nature and dynamics of culture industry in the West. These works are little difficult to understand for those who are not familiar with the German political tradition. Their language is little terse and loaded with unfamiliar jargons. Keeping these aspects in mind, I try to talk as simple as possible. In their works, Horkheimer and Adorno gave references to Western artists and art forms to make sense of the culture industry emerging in the West. This cultural industry has now expanded to different parts of the globe, including in India. Over the decades, even in India witnessed the growth of culture industry. Hence, I will occasionally take examples from India to make Indian audience understand Horkheimer and Adorno's theorization of culture industry. Art and culture are always an integral part of human civilization. Prior to the consolidation of capitalism and its subsequent development into monopoly capitalism, art forms enjoyed considerable autonomy in the pre-capitalist societies. Although certain aspects of culture received royal attention and patronage, the painters, writers, singers, architects, etc., then enjoyed considerable autonomy. Art forms were then mostly evocative responses of individual emotions. The West produced great artists like Michelangelo, Mozart, Beethoven, and many others. Similarly, in India, we had Tulsidas, Tansen, Tyagaraja, etc., who are great writers, musicians, and singers. Religion then used to be a unifying force of different art forms: music, dance, theater, and architecture. Two kinds of art forms then existed, which were clearly distinguishable: class art and folk art. The class form of art was meant for the educated and enlightened classes or groups of people, while the folk forms emerged from the experience of masses at the grassroots. True, all these art forms also directly or indirectly subserved the class interests of that period. But one cannot say that all artists of that time were at the beck and call of their masters. Monetary considerations were then secondary to religious and personal concerns. But the autonomy that the artists enjoyed earlier disappeared with the development of capitalism. In the Communist Manifesto, Marx and Engels explained that as capitalism advances, art and culture gets commodified, and even artists end up as wage workers. Commodification of art and culture reached the highest peak during the phase of monopoly capitalism, with the development of a culture industry. In monopoly phase, culture industry attains the status of an industrial corporation and starts operating more or less like other industrial and business corporations. They produce cultural products for mass consumption through films, music, magazines, TV serials, advertisements, etc., all for enhancing commercial value. Like other businesses, culture industry creates, desires, and sells cultural products to earn profits. Characterizing this phenomena as a phenomena of late capitalism, Horkheimer and Adorno argue that culture industry replaced religion, which earlier expressed the totality of culture. In the age of monopoly capitalism, culture ceases to be an evocative emotional responses of an individual. Culture forms becomes products of industry created for instrumental reason, for governance, mass consumption, and for profits. Horkheimer and Adorno identify certain peculiar features of a culture industry. Promoting art and culture is never the objective of a culture industry. It has no regard for either class or folk art. All that it aims is profit. For that, it seeks particular level of standardization that makes mass production of products for profit possible. Culture industry commodifies even genuine art, be it class or folk. Culture industry is detrimental to high art, which requires better intellect and inquisitiveness to view, understand, and enjoy. Products of Mozart and Beethoven cannot be relished by all. Hence, culture industry dilutes, makes use of bits and pieces where needed, so that the products will have more consumers. Adorno points out how Beethoven music is used and misused by Hollywood industry. We can see parallels in Indian context also. In India, classical Hindustani or Carnatic music are Bharatanatyam and Odissi dances. They appeal to intellectual class with some amount of taste for these art forms. They cannot be relished by all sections. Hence, culture industry cannot promote them as they are. Culture industry will lower their standard of these, you can say, classical music or dance forms, so that they would fetch maximum number of consumers. In pre-monopoly era, art forms were identified with individual artists and they could not be replicated. But modern technologies used by culture industry enable duplication and wide dispersal or distribution of cultural products. Apparently, there are now more choices today. We have many newspapers, magazines, radio and TV channels, and movies. But Horkheimer and Adorno point out that all these products are alike, and in essence, they are all the same. They can be grouped into certain formula. They repeat them again and again with slight changes and modifications. In India, earlier there was Doordarshan, but today we have around hundreds of TV channels. Every year, Indian film industry produces hundreds of movies. Have all these developments brought new and novel things? No. In almost all news channels in India, we come across same kind of news and same orchestrated debates, and every channel has someone like Arnav Goswami. Similarly, most TV serials are predictable. because they follow set formula and cliches. When I sit with my wife to watch Tamil TV serials, I cannot keep my mouth shut. Much to the irritation of my wife, I start giving a running commentary. Even though I do not understand the language, I can accurately predict what is going to be the next scene and what is going to be the next dialogue. My wife gets irritated and drives me out. How do I know what is going to happen in the TV serials? You don't need to be an astrologer or a great intellectual for that. If you have seen TV serials in any Indian language for about a year, then you can predict any TV stories in any Indian language. Because even though the language differs, the stories, characters, dialogues are almost the same. This is true even in case of the movies. They are all repetitive and interchangeable. That is what Horkheimer and Adorno pointed out in their writings. Expansion of culture industry does not bring anything new. The same thing in familiar forms, as like old wine in new bottles. There is no new ideas, no novel subjects, and no diversity. Do the content of the products produced by culture industry reflect truth and empower the people? Far from it. Its products are devoid of any redeeming features. You don't need great IQ to read, listen, or watch the cultural products, which are there basically to appeal to our instincts. They stifle inquisitiveness, spontaneity, and creativity. They are targeted for pleasure, and they encourage passivity and docility. They are banal, meaning they lack originality, freshness, or novelty. They stunt the responses of the people and makes them fearful of any innovative things. They make the people believe and accept the ideology that enslaves them. The people who swallow these cultural products, they remain in make-believe world and assume that the world outside is the same as what is shown in the movies and TV serials. They often identify themselves with the characters in the TV or TV shows or in the movies and idolize those characters. All that creates an illusionary world and make the audience passive recipients of whatever is served to them. Horkheimer and Adorno say that the purpose of cultural industry is not only to earn profits, but also to reproduce docile, pliant, and uncritical citizens who will never go beyond the world of appearances. Culture industry works as instrument of mass control and mass deception. The products of culture industry cement the status quo, stunt the audience responses, and impose capitalist ethos and values. They are often used to spread anti-democratic forces and regressive thoughts. Just as it does not elevate the consumers, culture industry also does not empower the artists. Culture industry kills individuality of genuine artists and forces autonomous realm of art into the vortex of market economy. Only those artists who play according to the rules of the game, they survive in this industry. As the products of culture industry are hollow and bereft of truths, Adorno outrightly rejects them. He speaks of the need to rescue art from the shackles of monopoly capitalism and make it autonomous and emancipatory. To him, only autonomous art can be authentic and original. It expresses human spontaneity and expresses individuality in true sense. Only autonomous art can provide an alternative vision of reality, highlight the inequalities and injustices in the society, and challenge the status quo. Hence, Adorno advocates the need for rejuvenation of autonomous art to fight the onslaught of culture industry. These ideas of Horkheimer and Adorno, more particularly Adorno, on culture industry continue to be debated in several disciplines, in philosophy, media studies, political science, sociology, and cultural studies. While there are many who appreciate it, there are also critics who looked at the theory from a different perspective. Walter Benjamin and Adorno had intense debates on this issue. Benjamin, who was also in a way associated with Frankfurt School, believed that technological changes in the culture industry have democratized culture and relieved art from the clutches of the kings and the religion. It made cultural products available to the masses at cheaper rates. I give my own example. There was a time when I could not afford even 500 rupees to buy the entry ticket to watch Jagjit Singh's Ghazal show. But now, even after his death, I can listen to him by buying a cassette or watching his earlier shows for free on TV or on internet. Walter Benjamin cites such examples to show that modern technological developments have emancipatory potentiality. Another scholar, Deborah Cook, who wrote extensively on Adorno's contributions, contended that Adorno makes wild generalizations about commodification of artists. Cook cites artists like Schoenberg, Beckett, and Kafka, who could resist commodification of their art. Terry Eagleton, another scholar, believes that Adorno overestimated the power of the capitalist ideology and believed that the society would continue to be under the spell of all-pervasive reification. Frederick Jameson and Jim Collins, they pointed out that Adorno's idea of culture industry was historically limited. In the sense, it may be valid, his ideas may be valid in 1940s, but the world has changed since then. And the conditions which were existing are not the same today. Marxist critics also feel disappointed to see that Adorno's strategy for opposing the culture industry is devoid of Marxist analysis. It is not clear how this genuine autonomous art could be restored without an agency. Further, Adorno was silent on avant-garde movements which gave birth to alternate films, theater, and art forms in the post-war world. Despite such limitations, we can still say that Horkheimer and Adorno's analysis of culture industry deserve attention and appreciation even today, because barring some certain exceptions, film industry, TV, social media, and advertising agencies are not really free and are in the control and service of the corporate sector. This being my understanding of the theory of culture industry, I leave it to you to decide whether you agree with their analysis or not. An orthodox scholar in critical theory may not like me taking the liberty to explain the theory with day-to-day examples. But I felt this is how I could make the people understand political theory. If you agree with me and enjoyed my lecture, I request you to like and subscribe the channel and inform like-minded friends or students interested in political theory to watch my lectures on YouTube. Thank you very much and see you soon with another lecture. Bye for now.